Everyone doing all right? Doing good? Yeah. All right, grab your Bibles. There's Bibles everywhere. Joshua chapter 3. There's orange ones, there's yellow ones. If you don't have your own, some of the verses that we'll share will be up on the screen, the page number anyway, so you have to look for yourself. But please grab a Bible. We're going to be parked there in Joshua 3. I'm going to actually read that chapter with you. We've been here in our living room here for the last couple weeks. We've gone through Joshua chapter 1. We've gone through Joshua chapter 2. You know, our theme verse. What's up, Rome? Our theme verse. Joshua says, choose today whom you'll serve. We can choose to serve anything else, but we can choose to serve the Lord. And that's what we're shooting for here. Joshua and Jesus have the same Hebrew name, Yeshua. They're the deliverer. Joshua is delivering the people into this geographic place of peace and prosperity. But what Jesus wants to do is bring you into a place, not a geography, but a person of peace and rest, and that's himself. And so they're very, very similar. But we've gone through the first two chapters. We see this amazing story unfolding, and we're in chapter 3. I'm going to read that with you, like I said, in a moment. You know, this story of Joshua with the Jordan River swelled at harvest time, and they're going to pass through the river, and all these the walls of Jericho are going to come crashing down, and we've got spies, and we've got prostitution, and we've got war, and we got all these miracles are going to happen. It's an incredible story, but really, it's not just like a movie. It almost sounds like The Hobbit, you know? It sounds like it would make a great movie with special effects and graphics, and it'd be a lot of fun. But listen, if this is just a story, if I can't lay this thing over my life and learn about the nature and character of God and allow the story to actually persuade my heart towards the Lord, then it's just a story and I don't want to waste my time, and I know you don't want to either. And so I believe that this story has massive implications on our life. Paul says it perfectly in Romans 15:4, where he says that all scripture, all of it, everything in this book was written so we might learn. It's not just a story, it's actually that we might learn something about the Lord and learn something about ourselves. So, that being said, let's go to Joshua chapter 3, and I'm going to read it with you. I read out of the New Living Translation. I don't know if you all have it, but here we go. You guys ready to go? Everyone have a Bible? Are you cheating yourself? Don't cheat yourself. I could tell you a fib. I could fib right here, right now. You'd never know if you don't have a book in front of you. You could. Are you ready? Here we go. After the spies come back, right, this is what happens. He sends them out to spy out the land and make sure, see, hey, can we conquer this thing? So early the next morning, Joshua and all the Israelites left Acacia Grove and arrived at the banks of the Jordan River, where they camped before crossing. 3 days later, the Israelite officers went through the camp, giving these instructions to the people. When you see the Levitical priests carrying the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God, move out from your positions and follow them. Since you have never traveled this way before, they will guide you. Stay about a half a mile behind them, keeping a clear distance between you and the Ark. Make sure you don't come any closer. Then Joshua told the people, purify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do great wonders among you. In the morning, Joshua said to the priests, lift up the Ark of the Covenant and lead the people across the river. And so they started out and went ahead of the people. The Lord told Joshua, today I will begin to make you a great leader in the eyes of all the Israelites. They will know that I am with you, just as I was with Moses. Give this command to the priests who carry the Ark of the Covenant. When you reach the banks of the Jordan River, take a few steps into the river and stop there. So Joshua told the Israelites, come and listen to what the Lord your God says. Today you will know that the living God is among you. He will surely drive out the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Hivites, the Perizzites, the Girgashites, Amorites, Jebusites ahead of you. I think I got them right. Who knows? Look at the Ark of the Covenant, which belongs to the Lord of the whole earth. That's important. And it will lead you across the Jordan River. Now choose 12 men from the tribes of Israel, one from each tribe. The priests will carry the Ark of the Lord of all the earth. He keeps saying that. As soon as their feet touch the water, the flow of the water will be cut off upstream, and the river will stand up like a wall. So the people left their camp to cross the Jordan, and the priests who were carrying the Ark of the Covenant went ahead of them. It was the harvest season, and the Jordan was overflowing its banks. But as soon as the feet of the priests who were carrying the Ark touched the water at the river's edge, the water above that point began backing up a great distance away at a town called Adam, which is near Zarethan. And the water below that point flowed on into the Dead Sea until the riverbed was dry. Then all the people crossed over near the town of Jericho. Meanwhile, the priests who were carrying the Ark of the Lord's Covenant stood on dry ground in the middle of the riverbed as the people passed by. They waited there until the whole nation of Israel had crossed the Jordan on dry ground. Now, I read this several times this week, and I learned some things, and I've got three things I just want to share with you. I believe that God loves me, and he wants to teach me stuff, and so therefore, because I love you, I want to teach you some things if you'll give me that privilege, okay? So again, we can't just make it a good story. We got to lay this over our life and learn something and progress. So here's a couple things I want to share with you. Here's the first thing. You'll see it there right in verse 4 of chapter 3, and is that familiarity breeds contempt. When I say contempt, I don't mean contempt like I hate you. It's a false disregard. It's a nasty disrespect. It's the pushing off into the fringes that which deserves to be central in your life. And that's what happens when you become very, very familiar with something. Oh, it's just him. I remember who watched The Lion King? Oh, that's just you, Scar. Remember the hyenas? Oh, that's just you, Scar. I will be king, you know. So that's what happens when you're familiar with someone. So look in verse 4. Look verse 4. This is what he says here. It's not just a good story. Since you have never traveled this way before, the priests will guide you with the Ark of the Covenant. And above the Ark, what was there above the Ark between the wings of the angels? God's manifest presence. The Lord was right there, and he was leading them. And so what does he say? He says, stay about a half a mile behind them, keeping a clear distance between you and the ark. Make sure you don't get too close. And why I'm saying that is that, and I love this church, and I love what we've done in here, and I love what we did in the old building where we made it kind of like a third area, like a coffee shop. It's comfortable. We got nice couches and chairs, and we want to make sure that all the good chairs are up front with cushions and good lighting and all this kind of stuff. And that's cool. We should be comfortable. But what happens a lot of times, we take that comfort a little bit too far, and we treat Jesus with a flippant attitude like it's no big deal. You're in the presence of the star breather. This is no game. This is no joke. You know what I'm saying? So I think that's what he's saying. Like, don't get too close to this God. Like Jesus, he tore the veil. When he said it's finished, it's like, okay, now you can come in. You can come in and see my Father, but never forget he's the star-breathing creator of the universe who crushes nations who don't obey him, who lowers kings who ignore him. That's who this God is. And when you walk into his room, it's permission, but you don't go in and say, yo, daddy, yo. That's not what happens. He's God. He's God of all gods, and we should treat him that way. This is some things that I think that we do. I think that we treat God's salvation as common. You see it all the time. I'm a Christian. You know, it's could do this. You know, this it's just a little white lie. I'm not too drunk. You see, your little white lie put Jesus on the cross. Just like a murder, just like a rape, it doesn't make any difference. There's no such thing as a little sin. We do not ever, heaven forbid, we glorify our sin. Heaven forbid we do that. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 29, I want you to lay your eyes on God's word. Don't you dare take my word for this. Listen, you got that book right here. People have died to make sure you have it in your hands. They've died for you. Hebrews 10:29, what does it say? Just think No, I'll give you a minute to get there. Just got a little ahead of me. Okay. Just think how much worse the punishment will be for those who have trampled on the Son of God and have treated the blood of the covenant, which made us holy, as if it were common and unholy, and have insulted and disdained the Holy Spirit who brings God's mercy to us. So listen, I steal Theo's line. There's a God and I'm not him. But I don't know everything there is to know about God. Paul who wrote half the New Testament, says who can know the thoughts of this God that he's writing, right? But I don't know exactly what God senses or feels every time we tell a little white lie or just, you know, I didn't drop the F-bomb, but I just used the A word. And I say this, I'm guilty. Like, I'm not going, you know, you guys are doing it, but I'm like on the stage holy. Like, I do it too, but it's convicting for me. Like, I didn't use the F word, but I used the S word, and it's okay. Or I changed the sound of the F-bomb so that it's, I mean, So you think you snuck a frig by God? Like, he didn't hear it? Like, it's okay? Like, I'm sorry, but I don't even know how I should have said that, but yeah, I'm a work in progress. But we treat his, like, this, there's one thing that I can't stand. There's a song that Candy sings about lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Like, I can't tolerate that song. You understand? I can't tolerate that song. It drives me crazy. And let that be a motivator for your fight against sin. And he bled and died so that you could be free from that, and that you wouldn't do those things that trample on the blood of the covenant. Like, it's garbage. Like, it's no big deal. We treat it like it's no big deal. We also treat his word and his law as common. We do. I'm guilty. We're all guilty. I want to read some stuff from Psalm 119. You don't necessarily have to go there because I'm going to jump all over the place. And I'm not going to read, it's the longest psalm, and so don't get all scared. I'm just going to read a couple of the highlights. It's the ESPN highlight reel. So I commend these words to you so that this would be the posture of your heart about God's word. About God's word, okay? This is how important it is. This is the ad. I'm just saying, like I said, you got to lay this thing over your life so it can help, right? This is the attitude of the heart towards God's word that he desires for you. I'm not going to tell you where, it's just in there, okay? You can read this later, Psalm 119. You have charged us to keep your commandments carefully. But my actions would consistently reflect your decrees. I will study your command. I won't read it. I will study your commandments and reflect on your ways. I will delight in your decrees and not forget your word. I am always overwhelmed with the desire for your regulations. Help me understand the meaning of your commandments, and I will meditate on your wonderful deeds. Give me the privilege of knowing your instructions. Give me an eagerness for your laws rather than a love for money. How I delight in your commands, how I love them. Exclamation point. I meditate on your age-old regulations. Oh, Lord, they comfort me. This is awesome. This is how I spend my life, obeying your commandments. Like this guy here, it's not in the word to glorify this author, go, oh, well, that guy's really awesome. It's in there so that you would learn to be just like that. That should be the mirror of your life. So when you look at God's word, it shouldn't be a burden that you read every day. Oh, I got to read this old book that tells me I can't do anything. Oh, I delight in your decrees. This is how I live my life. I meditate on it day and night so I might prosper in all that I do. That's the attitude that we should have. But we treat his word. And we treat his life, and look, I'm just like, Jesus always raises the bar, right? He always raises the bar. If I ever say, hey, just give him 5 minutes in the morning, kick me in the shin. I read those words, and I don't see, oh, just give him 5 minutes in the morning. Does anyone see that? I don't see it. I don't see it. Here's the other thing that we do. Not only do we treat his salvation as common, we treat his word as common, but we treat him, himself, as common. Hebrews 12, 28. Please go there. Hebrews 12, 28. Receive these words. You ready? Since we are receiving, that's us, since we are receiving a kingdom that is unshakable. Someone? There we go. Since we are receiving a kingdom that is unshakable, let us be thankful and please God. Who wants to please God? Raise your hand. Yeah, right, okay. We want to please God. Well, this is how you do it. By worshiping him with holy fear and awe. For our God is a devouring fire. I get the casual. But that doesn't mean that God's the big guy upstairs. He's not cool with our little sins. And the cross at Calvary, not Calgary, the cross at Calvary is insane awesome. And when we put our eyes back on the cross of Calvary and we see this God who created the heavens and the earth, who split the Red Sea, who shaked the mountains, who could bring down kings, and he's mindful of you, it should put you in a posture of a loving father, but of like awesome power. This is who this God is. He spoke and the planets came out of his mouth. This is the God of the Bible. This is the God that we serve. And he shouldn't be treated as flippant or common. Deuteronomy 4:24 also says, not only is he a devouring fire, but he's a consuming fire. He's a consuming fire. So the first thing I think that this story teaches us is that familiarity does breed contempt. And so as a Christian soldier, you have to fight. You have to fight our natural tendency to be lax with the things of God, to be lax with the Word of God, and to be lax with God himself. He is a consuming fire, this God, and he should be treated as such. Here's the second thing. You ever hear anybody say, "Hey, you better get right"? Did you ever hear anybody say that? You probably said it to somebody because you think you're holy, right? Yeah, you better get right. Well, that's the second thing. Sounds like... You better get right. That's the second thing. You better get right. Let me tell you what I'm talking about. Look in verse 5. Back in our text in Joshua chapter 3. Look at verse 5. Then Joshua told the people, "Purify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do great wonders among you." Now, we've said this before. It's worth echoing again that when God acts on our behalf, he's not just doing it to be nice to you. He's not just doing it to bless you. He's not just doing it to make you happy, to make your day. He's not just doing it to get you out of a jam. Although he does do those things, those are the byproduct of what he does. But when he does things on your behalf, he's doing it for himself. Here's a couple of verses for you. Ezekiel 20, verse 9. "But for the sake of my name, I brought them out of Egypt." See, he didn't bring us out of Egypt, this nation of Israel, 2 million strong, to be nice to them because they were making bricks with no straw. That was my best Yul Brynner. He was bringing them out so he could display his power over the most powerful person on earth. That's what he was doing. That's what he was doing. And here's another one, Isaiah 48:9. "For my own namesake and praise, I delay my wrath." The only reason you draw another breath is to bring glory to God. That's the reason you live. That's a good spot too. You guys are getting it. So it says here we need to purify ourselves. Some translations say you have to sanctify ourselves. What does that mean? You've got to get right. See, we got sin in our life, and see, what happens is, back in the day, when he was telling these people, just like he's here telling us here today, but back then, they actually had a physical ceremony. Like, they would actually go home, let's just call it a shower. They would literally clean themselves. It was an outward expression of what was supposed to be happening on the inside. See, God's always after what's going on the inside, okay? Like, a circumcision didn't identify you, didn't really make you God's people if you didn't believe in them. You could slice and dice all you want. It wouldn't make any difference if you didn't believe in them. Ouch! And it's the same thing. You could cleanse yourself with scouring pads, and it wouldn't make any difference if you didn't actually have something going on inside. And so he says, you need to prepare yourself. Why? Because I'm about to do something awesome in your life. See, up to this point, they're not like us. We have a distinct advantage. We can look back on history and go, hey, he opened up the Jordan River and they got to walk through it. Like, that's amazing. But these people at this point, they didn't know what he was going to do. So here comes Joshua and he's laying down the rules for these people. He's like, hey, listen, everybody, purify yourself. God's about to do something amazing. They don't have no idea what he's about to do, but they do it. The reason why he wants them to do it is because they need to be ready to receive what's going to happen. Like, he could have done it, but when God does something, remember, it's for his own namesake. He wants credit. He wants fame for his actions. He doesn't waste a miracle. And he's about to do something. He wants people to understand and receive where it's coming from, who's providing it, and then give them the ability, the boldness to proclaim this truth, the goodness of God, to everyone they run into. And that's why we need to prepare ourselves by getting rid, purging the sin in our life. Here's three things that I believe that sin does. Sin distracts us from the work at hand, from the calling in our life. Sin will absolutely 100% confuse you so that you don't know where blessing's coming from. You won't understand. You'll call it karma. You won't understand. And here's the third one, is that sin just flat out blocks God from working in your life. Let me give you some examples. As we get our head and heart right, what I mean by this is priorities, by the way. Jesus talks about this clearly. Go to Luke chapter 9, the words of Christ himself. I want you to see what he's talking about. Now, of course, you know, Jesus, he's a strange bird in that he talks in ways that are a little bit confusing to some, and he actually does it on purpose, maybe to confuse some folks. He wants those that really want it, that have ears to hear, to come after it. And he doesn't make it really easy. But he's going to talk about getting your head right here, getting your priorities right, getting rid of the sin in your life so you can actually live out the life that he's called you to. So let's look here. Let's just read this here. Luke chapter 9, verse 57 through to the end of the chapter. It's a short section. As they were walking along, someone said to Jesus, I will follow you wherever you go. But Jesus replied, foxes have dens to live in, and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place even to lay his head. He said to another person, come follow me. The man agreed, but he said, Lord, first let me return home and bury my father. But Jesus told him, let the spiritually dead, or just in some translations, let the dead bury their own dead. Your duty is to go and preach about the kingdom of God. Another said, yes, Lord, I will follow you, but first let me say goodbye to my family. But Jesus told him, anyone who puts a hand to the plow and then looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. Now, first and foremost, Jesus is not a meanie. He's not a meanie. He's not trying to ruin your life and say, you know, you. Because listen, if he's the Word of God, if he's God of gods, and he wrote this stuff for all intents and purposes, and he said we should honor our mother and father, so you know this apparently contradicts that. So it can't mean be mean to your parents. Forget your family. Let him, he's dead. Let him. But that's not what it's all about. There's a lesson there. That's why I said everything that we learn in Scripture is to teach us something that's not just a cool story. Look at the first thing. You know, this foxes have dens and birds have nests. The Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Like, He's not telling you that if you're going to be a disciple of Jesus, that you have to be homeless. Like, that's not, there's a poverty gospel going through Christianity that says you have to give everything away, you have to live in a junky house, you can't drive a nice car, you can't have anything nice to be a Christian. That's not true. It's not true. What he's saying here is that material, the love of and the gathering of and the hoarding of stuff and the obsession of my mind to gather stuff and money and the things that it'll buy, they distract us from the work that he's called us to bring glory to the Father, to make disciples of Christ, and to spread the kingdom of God. Those things distract sin. They're sin, and they distract us from the work God has for us. Material distracts. Here's the second thing. This second one, I'm gonna just throw two explanations out. You guys got to do with it what you will. Okay? This is me over here now, because I'm not quite sure. But I'm going to throw a couple things out at you, and you can test them. The second person says, let me return home and bury my father. Well, I don't know. It doesn't necessarily say that the person, that there was a dead person. Just hear me out on this. I think that there's two options here, and again, you test it. I think this tells us that sometimes there's some worldly duties, that there's some cultural norms that people hold us to. And listen, we're in America and we're in the southern part of America, and the way that we normally live life here is way different than what they do in Southern California. And it's way different than what they do in the Pacific Northwest. Every area that we have in our country and in our world has its own little culture and its own little societal norms that this is what you're supposed to do. Would you agree? We do. And Jesus, I believe, is telling us here that those things are fine, but don't you dare let them trump my mission. Don't let those things take precedence over me. I am what? Center. I am center, and I'm to stay there. Don't you push me into the fringes. So I think that might be it. But I also think, and I'm not sure. Because, Jesus is, he says some stuff that, and a lot of, we just don't understand a lot of it. But it says, let me return home and bury my father. Like, my dad's still alive. And I started thinking about that. And, it tells us that we should meditate on the word, right? So I'm meditating on this word, and I start thinking, I'm like, maybe this young man actually still has a dad. So in other words, he's younger. He's a young fella. And I know that in my experience in ministry that sometimes people that are kind of younger, that there's this thing in our culture, and it's false, that you have to be so prepared and so ready. There's like this false age requirement and the standard that people have that they impose on others, that before you go do this with Jesus, like, I know that this guy can do it, but I'm not ready to give up this stuff yet. I'm not ready to give up my drink, and I'm not ready to give up Lady Chase. I'm not ready to do all this because and be a Christian and go tell people about Jesus. Like, I'm not ready for that. I love young people. You know why I love young people? One of my prayers, and I want you guys to join me in this. I'm put it into your prayer journal. Someday, a couple years, I'd like to see 400 or 500 youth and 20-somethings in this church. You know why? You give a teenager or a 20-something something that's real, and they can sink their teeth into it, and they believe they can change the world. They do. Even if they can't, they believe they can. They can. And there's nothing that's thicker and richer and yummier than the gospel of Jesus Christ. To go out across the world and to fight evil and to push back darkness and to gather souls for the King. What could be better than that? So that's what I love young people, but see, a lot of people think that you're too young and you should don't speak unless you're spoken to. Oh, didn't that just chap you when your parents told you that? Yeah. I wanted you to read something. 1 Timothy 4:12. Got us something to say about it. 1 Timothy 4:12, there's this guy Paul. He's writing most of this New Testament. He's going around. He's getting whipped, beaten, and put in jail and all this stuff. And he's planting churches and appointing elders. And he's teaching and launching these churches. And he says this to his young protege, Timothy, don't let anyone think less of you because you are young. Be an example to all believers be an example to all believers in what you say, in the way you live, in your love, your faith, and your purity. Until I get there, focus on reading the scriptures to the church, encouraging the believers, and teaching them. Amen. Yeah. Listen. You might not think you're ready, and you might think that someone in your life isn't ready, but what God says someone's ready, they're ready, right? And so, that doesn't matter. I don't care if he could speak through a donkey, he could speak through anyone. If he could speak through an ass, I got to do it. If he could speak through an ass, he could speak through Michael. Woo! Woo! Listen, I quit having fun in church. I don't even know where I was. Oh, yeah, Luke. Oh, I have to. Praise the Lord. Help me. Sin distracts. Here's the third thing that Jesus is talking about here. And it's this. This is a tender spot. Don't throw anything at me. Family distracts. See, family distracts. And you can see here, he says, yes, Lord, I will follow you, but let me first say goodbye to my family. And Jesus says, anyone who puts a hand to the plow and then looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. Is he saying, I'm a meanie and you should just neglect your family, to heck with them? See, that's not it. See, again, if Jesus is the Word that became flesh and that his Spirit is the one inspired this book, he's already said some things, and so he can't, by nature, contradict what he's already said, or he wouldn't be God. And so he said in Genesis, way, way, way back when, the family's good. He says, it's not good for a man to be alone, right? So he gives him a wife. And so therefore, not only is it good that he got a wife, but the flip side is true too. If it's good that he got a wife, then it's good for the wife because she got a husband. In Psalm 127:3, it says, children are a gift from the Lord. So you can see, it's not that family is bad. Family is good. I love my wife. I love my 1,000 children. I love them. I love them. I love them. I love them. However, they are to maintain a position that is a little bit more to the fringes than Jesus, if you will. You guys got me? Listen, I love my wife more than anyone on this earth, just not as much as I love Jesus. And what he's saying here is that this family that I've given you, you ruin it. See, that's our nature. We're sinful people, and from sinful people come sinful processes. And so what happens is he gives us a wife, he gives us a husband, he gives us family, and then what do? We make them God. And we go chasing kids around, spending all of our resources, time and focus and money and cars, chasing around playing soccer and twirling and baseball and all these things. And listen, 99% of these kids, like if they're really, really good, some of them will actually get to play travel ball. Then if you haven't spent all of your money, then it's gone. And I got news for you, 99.9% of these kids, even if they're good, they ain't making the bigs. They ain't making it. And what we've done is we've spent all of our resources on the family. That offering plate comes by, you couldn't put a nickel in it because you spent it all chasing your kid around travel ball to play soccer or baseball. It's crazy. Hey, can you help? We're mowing an old lady's yard this weekend. Can't travel ball. See, they're not going to make the big leagues.
But what we can do is we can take that which God has given us. See, the scriptures say that if you have found a wife, you have found a treasure and favor with the Lord.
Husbands, seriously? Let me give you another run at that. If you found a wife, you found a treasure and favor with the Lord. Yeah, hello.
But we take this family that God gave us and we put all this pressure on them that they're to become our idol because we easily give all of our resources to it. And instead of training up the kid to know the Lord, and instead of training him to worship Christ, and instead of making a disciple of this young man or woman, or instead of teaching him Christ-like character and integrity, we're chasing around a baseball. Like, there's nothing wrong with sports, but these things that God gives us, all good things come from above, but we have to treat them right or we ruin them. See? See, God gives us a delicious steak, right? Woo! Come on. A delicious steak, medium rare, sizzling on one of them black plates. You can hear it, right? And that's good. And then we tear into that thing. We don't say thank you. We get done, we pile on some pie, and we have some ice cream, and we take all these things that are good, and we just are disgusting gluttons and ruin what God has given us. And it's the same thing with our family. He gives us something good, and we ruin it because it becomes too much of a priority. Not that it's bad. You hear me? Our families are good. Our families are good and they are a gift from God. But sometimes they distract. Do me a favor, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. I want to say something, especially like that, if it's not supported by Scripture. 1 Corinthians 7:17 And I know most Bible students say that Paul was never married, but we don't know. But this is what he says. I want you to be free from the concerns of this life. An unmarried man can spend his time doing the Lord's work and thinking how to please him. But a married man has to think about his earthly responsibilities and how to please his wife. His interests are divided. In the same way, a woman who is no longer married, or has never been married, can be devoted to the Lord and holy in body and in spirit. But a married woman has to think about her earthly responsibilities and how to please her husband. I am saying this for your benefit, not to place restrictions on you. I want you to do whatever will help you serve the Lord best with as few distractions as possible. So you see, God's not saying that this wife that he gave you or this husband that he gave you or these beautiful children that he gave you are bad. They're good. Just don't let them get in the way of what I've commissioned for you to do. If I've given you these children, don't teach them all this stuff that means nothing. Teach them about me. Teach them to worship me. Teach them to serve me. Teach them to love me. Teach them to pray. Let them see you praying. Let them see you in your rocking chair reading your Bible. Let them catch you on your knees praying. Make them come in here and listen to us sing with our hands lifted high. Let them see that stuff. That's what matters. Go make disciples. Go make disciples. And you know, your first disciples had to be your kids. Had to be your kids. That's what we need to be doing. Sin distracts us, for sure. Sin also, like I said, confuses us, for sure. You know, the scriptures tell us that evil itself comes disguised often as an angel of light. Disguised. I was stripping my house down today looking for a mask. I couldn't find one. But just think about that. Like, you put a mask on, and what is it to do? It's to confuse the other people so they don't know who this really is. And that's exactly what sin does. It confuses people so they don't, when the blessing comes, they don't know where it came from, because sometimes the enemy disguises himself. He puts on a God mask so that everyone goes, oh, this or that. They don't know where it's coming from. That's what sin does to us. Let me give you an example. Have you guys ever talked to someone who's a who's a known, like, I don't hide it, it's out here on my sleeve, Christ follower, and they're having an affair or they're getting ready to leave their spouse, and you're telling them, you're pleading with them the truth that you're about to cancer your life, you might as well drink battery acid, you're going to destroy your wife, you're going to destroy your kids, you're going to destroy your business. This is not what God wants for you. He hates divorce. And you tell them that and they're like this. They're glazed over because they're confused. They're so wrapped up tight in sin, they can't see it. They think, oh, God's released me from that. Really? So he's going to contradict his word that says, I hate divorce and adultery is a sin. He doesn't do that. But we impose that stuff on ourselves. Why? So we can feel better. So sin confuses us like crazy. Or perhaps, and you guys have seen that a million times, I know have, God, like, you know someone, right? And they're a wreck. And God intervenes and intervenes and intervenes. And he's like, will you wake up? It's me, right? And they're like, just good, you know, it's good luck, you know, just some karma. They're so wrapped up tight in sin, they don't have any clue where it's coming from. And this is nothing new. You know, back when Jesus was walking this earth, there was a group of people over there in Israel, and they had the Old Testament. Listen, they had the Old Testament, the first five books of the Bible, they had it memorized. That's insane, right? They had it memorized. They knew so much about God, they just didn't have a clue if he came up and kicked them in the shins. God could walk up, because he did, and say boo, and they just try to kill him. Didn't even recognize him when he was there. That's sinful to be so legalistic. Ugh, pukey, right? And they were attributing Jesus' miracles to the power of Satan instead of the power of God. That is what I'm talking about sin wraps us up so tight we can't even recognize truth. We can't recognize when God blesses. Like Jesus comes into the scene, he's performing all these miracles, helping people out, right? These Pharisees should be thrilled. Finally, after all these years, this promised Messiah is here. Woo! Let's kill him. Those stubborn Jews. I can say that. I can say that. I am a stubborn Jew. Sin definitely distracts. Sin confuses us. We need a head and a heart alignment. Here's the third thing. Sin just flat out blocks. It blocks Jesus from doing things in your life. See, he was about to open up the Jordan River, gushing over its banks. It's harvest time and it's over the banks. And he's about to open it up so 2 million people could walk through the river. Like, they had all heard about what happened in the Red Sea, but see, all the people that actually went through the Red Sea, they were dead. So they've heard about this, and it's about to happen again. It's crazy. He says, purify yourselves, man. You need an alignment in your heart. You need an alignment in your heart. Psalm 50, verse 23. I have two doors in my house that lead out. One to the garage, and on it, it says, for him. I just need to be reminded of that, that that's the reason why I'm alive. And in the front door as I leave is this verse. And it says this. You got to listen. You got to purify yourself. Got to purify yourself because sin blocks. Listen to what it says. If you keep to my path, I will reveal to you the salvation of God. See, and don't just think about eternal salvation. Like, I get it. Like, we got to believe, you got to keep believing. Like, you can't believe it today and not believe it tomorrow, back and forth, okay? Nobody wants that. But we're not talking about eternal salvation. We're not talking about glory. We're talking about the storms of life. I need deliverance. You know, my family's falling apart. My career's falling apart. I got no money. I got the rent due and the car's busted and my friends hate me and blah, 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 blah. We got all this stuff, right? Everyone's got stuff. And I need help. I need deliverance from this. I have bad memories that have scarred me. I've got deep wounds from my childhood. My marriage is falling apart. I got addictions. I need deliverance from this stuff. And what does he say? I want to help you, but your sin is blocking my ability to work in your life. He said, he puts a stipulation on this. There's three words. If you keep, you got to stay there. If you keep to whose path? His path. If you keep to my path, you will see the deliverance. That's what you need to do. If there's a stipulation, if you stop, if you turn from your sin and embrace Christ and live for him and follow the Spirit's leading in all things, you'll see me deliver. You'll see me do amazing things. But if you do not do this, you will see nothing. And the fool who thinks God's going to intervene and do great things for them, he doesn't bless unfaithfulness. That's not God's gig. He doesn't go, oh, they didn't give anything again this week. Woohoo! They asked people to help with the children's ministry, and they passed by again and said, oh, screw that clipboard. Woo, let's bless them. Doesn't work that way. Yeah, I'm a work in progress. I'm sorry. Email me. Here's a, thanks, bro. It's not right. You're right. I'm sorry. Let's get a little crazy. There's a couple of examples in Scripture of exactly what I'm talking about. The first, the most obvious, is the Exodus. The whole story of the Exodus. Here's 2 million people in Egypt, right? Slavery, bondage, whipped, beaten, just awful. They're treated like animals, starved, make bricks with no straw, building all the pyramids, just treated like absolute garbage. And God promised them, I'm gonna bring you to this amazing place where you can prosper and be free and you can worship me and you can have peace and rest, life in a hammock. Come on. That's all you gotta do is keep to my path and I'll reveal to you this place. And experts say it should have taken 11 days. 40 years. 40 years. Why? Grumble, complaining, disobeying. They did not keep to his path. He promised to deliver them. I want to do this for you, you crazy people. Disobedience. 40 years until all but two of the people that left Egypt were dead. Another example that you see in Scripture is our boy King David. I mean, just an amazing man. The most amazing, dynamic king that probably ever lived. I mean, he had slayed Goliath, fought all these wars in the name of this God and conquered all these nations. He was a man after God's own heart. He wanted to see God triumphant and everyone would worship him. He wanted the things of God. And then he saw Bathsheba and he started popping off the commandments like crazy. He's coveting the neighbor's wife, that's one. Then he has sex with her, so there's adultery, there's two. And then he has her husband Uriah killed so he could keep her, that's murder. That's like three of the 10 commandments he breaks. So experts, and I'm by far not one, but experts think that Psalm 32 was written during this time of his life, that he wrote this. Listen to his words. This is what sin does. Oh, what joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sin is put out of sight. Yes, what joy for those whose record the Lord has cleared of guilt, whose lives are lived in complete honesty. Isn't that what we all want? So we're Christians, right? This is what you get, right? You're in. You're as white as snow. You're holy and blameless and without fault in the presence of Almighty God. Awesome. But, remember he said, if you keep to my path. Look what happens. So he sleeps with this woman. He has the guy killed. And all of a sudden, the joy just turns to anguish. And he says, when I refused to confess my sin, my body wasted away. And I groaned all day long. Day and night, your hand of discipline was heavy on me. My strength evaporated like water in the summer heat. Has anyone felt this before? The shame and the guilt of your sin. And he's feeling like those are not the words of a man or a woman who is rejoicing in their salvation. This is a man in pain. But then look what happens. This is for us. Listen. Finally, I confessed all my sins to you and stopped trying to hide my guilt. Let me just inject something. The scriptures say, certainly your guilt will find you out. Confess it before it crushes you, loved ones. I stopped trying to hide my guilt. I said to myself, I will confess my rebellion to the Lord, and you forgave me. All my guilt is gone. I reference 1 John 1:9 all the time. This guy needs it so bad, you probably do too. If you confess your sin to him, he is faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and to wipe out all the wickedness and to wipe out all the shame and the guilt that the sin carries along. He will bless you and clear all this away. Therefore, let all the godly pray to you while there is still time, that they may not drown in the flood waters of judgment. For you are my hiding place. You protect me from trouble. You surround me with songs of victory. It's amazing, this next line too. Remember, he says, if you keep to my paths, I will reveal to you the salvation of God. Look what he says here. The Lord says, I will guide you along the best path for your life. I will advise you and watch over you. Sin just flat out blocks God's blessing in your life. See, he wants to do things for us, but this big, fat, hairy sin is in the way. And one of my favorite verses in Scripture, and Mark shared it last night here at One Fire, and it's Colossians 2:6. He says, when we're talking about repentance and David, he sins, and the blessings of God are not pouring into his life anymore because he's feeling the weight of his sin and the guilt that goes along with it and the shame, and it actually manifests itself physically in his body, sickened by it. And that's not the life that Jesus came and lived and died and resurrected for you to live. He came that you might have life and have it abundantly. And so it says in the Colossians 2:6, just as you came to Christ, so walk in him. Amen. Just as you came to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, so you must continue to follow him. How did you come to Christ? You came to Christ because you were a wreck and your life was full of sin and you got sick and tired of being sick and tired and you were losing the fight and you realized you couldn't do it anymore and you went to Jesus and you said, Jesus, this is my life. It's awful. I don't want it anymore. Nothing's ever worked and I'm dumping it there and I'm repenting of that and I'm turning to you and this is the life I want now. And that's the day you came to Christ. But what he's saying here is you need to do that every single day. Every day that should be the posture of our lives. This is not right. This is not what I want. Repent, 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 repent. You got to dump sin. It distracts you from your calling. It confuses you as to where blessing is coming from. And sin flat out blocks the work of God in your life. Here's the third and final thing. This is not a popular one either. But you'll see it there in the text, verse 8 and verse 13. When you reach the banks of the Jordan River, take a few steps into the river and stop there. He continues that thought in verse 13 where he says, the priests will carry the ark of the Lord of all the earth. I kept saying that because he wants them to understand that he's the Lord of that water too. I believe that. As soon as their feet touch the water, the flow of the water will be cut off upstream and the river will stand up like a wall. So the third and final thing here I glean from this text is that blessing often follows obedience. What I mean by that is that most people, and myself included, like I'm not taking myself out of this equation, God, if you will do this and this and this and this, then I will do this. If you just, I need this job and I need this money and I need that girl, she's so hot. I mean, she's smart and she loves you, Lord. And if you'll just give me her, I will go all in on you. I'm all in. We'll see. Yeah, we say, God, if you'll do this and this, then I'll do that. And see, you know what? God's word actually says the exact same thing, but from a different perspective. He says that if you'll do this, well, then I'll do that. See, it's totally different. See, we all want to know his plan, and we want to know his path, and we want to know his purpose for us, like the long-range goal. We want to know that thing. Lord, if you'll just disclose to me exactly what you want me to do, then I'll do it. Frequent prayer of the Christian. Who should I marry, God? I don't know. I mean, why don't you just marry someone and then, love her as Christ loved the church. Well, why don't you just find that man and marry him and submit to him in all things as unto the Lord, and I'll bless your marriage. It doesn't make any difference, really. You know what I'm saying? Like, I think that's what he wants us to do. I think that the question of what job should I have? It's another one. What should I take this job? I don't know. Why don't you just go get a job and work unto the Lord? That's what he said. I mean, it doesn't make a difference what job you're at, right? When you're at that job, whether it's a good one or a bad one, pays a lot or pays nothing, work as unto the Lord. He's talked about it. How about what house, what town, what state, what region, what country, what should I do? I don't care, kid. Just wherever you land, love your neighbor. It's true, right? He's talked about these things. See, I think that God, I read this book and I believe that God's way more about the way than he is about the where or the what. I really do. Full disclosure, God. I need to have full disclosure, and then I'll go. And he's like, yeah, whatever. So I think that this story of Joshua is way cool. And I think it's an amazing story with spies and war and prostitution and all this miracles. And it's like, it'd make a great movie. It absolutely would make a great movie, there's no doubt. But you know what? If it doesn't really speak truth into your life, if it doesn't lay over your life and move your heart towards the Lord, then it just ends up being like one of those movies that we just had recently, the Noah movie. It's a cool movie, right? It just doesn't help you. Cool graphics. Trees that walk and talk and all that kind of good stuff. It looks like, you know, The Hobbit. Yeah, so it doesn't help. But I mean, it's entertaining. But see, this story right here, this could be one of those entertaining movies. But if it doesn't, if you can't lay it over your life and see the nature and character of God and let it move you towards him, it's just a story. It's just a story. But what I do believe is that it's a fresh reminder of who this God is. An all-powerful, nature-controlling, consuming, fire creator who is above all, before all, in all, and the end of all things, who should be worshipped with holy fear and awe. That's who he is. He's not to be treated flippantly. He's not to be treated as casual or common. He's not to be pushed into the fringes where other things belong. He belongs where, Mark? In the center. You're a yeller, Mark. He belongs where, Mark? In the center. That's where he belongs. Not pushed into the fringes. He's a God whose nature is to bless his people, but he wants fame and he wants credit for what he does. So as an ongoing discipline, an ongoing act of worship, we should have a posture of repentance so that we can receive his blessing, so we can know from who and from where it comes from, and that we would have the power to proclaim the goodness and the majesty of this God. And this amazing story of 2 million people passing through this rushing river on dry ground, is a perfect illustration of how God blesses faithful, obedient followers of Christ in the little things. Put your foot in the river, and I will stop the water. Seek first the kingdom, and I will provide. Move close to me, and I'll move close to you. That's who our God is. Amen.